Ladies and gentlemen, could I invite you to stop your private conversations? We'd like to begin this morning's session. I'm Ranulf Glanville and I'm president of the American Society for Cybernetics. As you know, this is an event that has been organized and proposed by two societies, the Bateson Idea Group. And I'm not sure that you have met the president of the Bateson Idea Group, who's Philip Gudemi. So I'd like to introduce Philip. And you have, of course, met the two main organizers. Nora Bateson, I think everyone met at length last night. But do you want to stand up and say hello? This is Nora, in case any of you missed her. And Pile Bunal is standing at the back, well hidden at the moment. But you will all have seen Pile. Pile was the American Society for Cybernetics representative on the, as chair as of the coordinating committee. So. And it is because of the great efforts of these people and the other people on the organizing committee and you in hustling up funds and all those sorts of things that we managed to be here to celebrate Gregory Bateson. And the idea that we have talked about, Nora and I, whenever we've discussed this, and Philip and I, when we first hatched this idea, which was about 18 months ago, is that not only is, of course, Gregory Bateson an extraordinarily important person, and he's important to both of us, that both societies, but he's someone who needs to be re-recognized, as it were, and who provides a source for going forwards. And so what we want to do is to look at ideas associated with Bateson, and to develop these, to meet together with people who are Batesonians and people who are cyberneticians, if I can differentiate us like that, and to provide a fertile ground for not only appreciating Bateson, who he was and what he did, but for moving that sort of thinking forward. Now, our first speaker was the ASC's first choice for a keynote speaker, Klaus Krippendorff. And Klaus, as I expect you all know, is the Gregory Bateson Term Professor at the School of Communication, Annenberg School of Communication, at the University of Pennsylvania. I got it right this time, didn't I? I always call it Philadelphia instead of Pennsylvania. I apologize to all you Americans for this appalling slip of the tongue. Klaus has been closely associated with Batesonian ideas, and has been a member of the ASC since before it was founded. And I'm not going to explain what I mean by that, because you will all have a chance to find out. What many of you may not know is that earlier this year, Klaus passed his 80th birthday. And he has been a sort of a major part of the ASC's life for the nearly half century that the society has been in existence. We recognized this in the first instance by making him an Emeritus Honorary Fellow of the society. But we decided that really wasn't quite enough. And in order to help him remember what he's been doing and look forward, and in order that everyone else here has a better chance of finding out about Klaus, we have made and wish to publish a little book. It's called Klaus Krippendorff, A Directory. And in here, you will find an introductory article primarily written by Stuart Umpleby with help from Pile and Larry Richards and a little from me, an official introductory bit by me. And then the main body of it is Klaus's own selection of his most important papers, books, and so on, together with links. Now, of course, having a paper version is always nice, but we have also put it on the ASC website where all the links are live. So you can go to the address given in this booklet and you'll be able to look at this wonderful body of work that Klaus has given us and from which he goes from strength to strength as a cybernetician, a communications theorist, content analysis, and, as he just told me, a recognized designer. He was just given an honorary doctorate in Sweden as a designer. So we are delighted to give this to him and to all of you as our token of recognition and appreciation. And of course, you will understand this is an ASC thing. I hope that those of you who come from BIG won't mind that occasionally the ASC does something and invites you to join with us in celebrating the things that we have to celebrate. There will be more later on in the conference. We've also placed Klaus's, really by now, very ancient dictionary of cybernetics on the web next door to the booklet, so you'll be able to look up a little bit more of his wisdom and thought. So I'm going to ask Klaus to come and give his address, his keynote address, to you. But before I do, I would say that after he has finished speaking, we will have coffee served in here, and I would ask you all to join us as we celebrate the destruction of one of Klaus's own designs. He knows nothing about this, as he knew nothing about the booklet, and in fact very few people know, but we have a little bit in mind and in stomach for the coffee interval. With that, Klaus, please, I welcome you. Thank you for being such an eternal member, and welcome to give your address.
Thank you. Well, Peter said she doesn't mind if I'm a little controversial, and I think I will be, despite the history of my participation, or maybe that is my history. And I struggled with the title, and this is my title. My aim is actually to continue Gregory Bateson's trajectory towards a critical, socially significant, and culturally and environmentally sensitive cybernetics. I think we have in some ways failed in this way, and I hope to recover that momentum. To me, this entails overcoming the persistent individualism and in cognitivism, radical constructivism, and biological foundation. It also entails overcoming the limitation of abstracting the observer out of the social practices of living, like in second-order cybernetics. I think when we talk about abstracting an observer, then we immediately come to issues of understanding. These are all mentalistic concepts that don't help us very much. I think we also need to overcome the Enlightenment conception of observation as determinist explanations, which are typical in the natural sciences, whether these are circular, causal, structural, logical, or holistic, at the expense of reflexive type of explanations, with which I will be ending. And then important to me, is perhaps most important to me, is overcoming the monological an undifferentiated conception of language that we are talking about. I was surprised yesterday, everyone was talking and nobody was talking about the talking. And also we have to overcome the claim of universalism, the idea that we have found the truth for everyone. And I think there's often, for example, on the internet, we find sometimes that cybernetics is a super scientific enterprise, and I think we have to simply be a little bit more humble and do the work that we need to do. So that is my aim, this is my plan, and I want to shift actually from an ecology of ideas to an ecology in language, particularly artifacts or patterns created in language. Then I will talk about two kinds of, or maybe three, kinds of species in the ecology of language, social theories, discourses, and that is actually my main interest. And then in the end, I turn the things around and talk about the discourse of cybernetics as opposed to the cybernetics of discourse. So, What are the ecology of ideas? I suggest that ideas are socially relevant only after they are articulated or in conversations, in writing, are enacted and make a difference in other people's lives. If you talk about the ecology of ideas, I have no idea what ideas you have unless you tell me. So I think one should draw when you talk about the articulations of the ideas, not about ideas. And I think when we replace the word ideas with articulations or with words, etc., we can study them. We don't need to get into mentalistic constructions, not study them as symbols, but as records of what they do with each other and how they interconnect, flourish, vanish over time, etc. So to me, it is clear, I wish to distinguish, I think, between three kinds of conceptions of ecology. Just to be clear that the word ecology is kind of a common parlance and nobody knows what it is, or everyone thinks it's a great thing to have. So I would say that we have to distinguish the common scientific ideas of ecology, which is a theory of how multiple species of biological organisms interact in their environment, reproduce themselves, cooperate, compete, and live from each other. And I think it's important to realize that all of these species fend for themselves in some ways without a sense of the whole. No animal in ecology knows very much beyond their own reach. And that applies also to human beings who are part of the ecology, in my opinion. Then there's a metaphorical conception, and that is a kind of a system that is manifest in the complexity of many patterns interacting with one another, forming viable wholes or not so viable wholes. In Bateson's use, ecology became something like the bedrock of being human, and demanding attention to the connectedness of patterns, the essential diversity and equilibria. A system that needs to be preserved, understood and preserved. I favor, or I'm getting into another and a third kind of conception of ecology, namely, and that has, I started from that actually, from my interest in design, in material artifacts, and I think the material artifacts, also technology if you want, form a particular type of ecology. And to me, that is a systematic account of how species of artifacts are reproduced and brought into interaction with one another, cooperate to form huge cultural complexes, or compete with each other by retirement or replacement. An ecology of artifacts exists, and that is, I think, the difference between the scientific conception and the ecology of artifacts exists only as an epiphenomenon of the history of creating these artifacts by human beings living together. So that it doesn't exist without human beings. To me, language is the primary human artifact. It's continuously reconstructed by its users. Instead of talking about an ecology of ideas, I invite you to talk about an ecology of artifacts or patterns or species created in language. And as I said yesterday, we have not talked about our talking, and that is what I would hope that we can do. Now, when we think about an ecology in language, we can identify numerous species or patterns of language, words, phrases, language games, theories, narratives, rituals, and literature. These are separate species which are reproduced and survive for some time in the conversations among people. And there are interesting phenomena in the ecology. For example, synonymous patterns compete with one another. Then choosing one is detrimental to the choice of the other. Or a more efficient pattern, we know that from Zipf's law, more efficient patterns have a better chance of survival within the ecology of language. Or compound species, narratives, larger narratives, sermons, ideologies, discourses, they protect its components by being jointly produced, so they're no longer independent. We can describe an ecology, any ecological interactions, in synchronically, in the case of language, phonetic shifts, etymologies, histories, and diachronically, that means as networks of co-occurrences, text statistics, dictionaries, encyclopedia, big data. Big data is now the kind of the latest interest because of the internet. We have an enormous amount of data available of a linguistic kind, and we can study them as ecologies. To me, again, what I said earlier, an ecology is grounded in the history of conversations, writings, in the interactions among very many people, but surprisingly, or not so surprisingly, only a few at a time. So they exceed or extend what we call conversation, but are based on it. Now let me talk about social theories as species in the ecology of language. Theories in general are preferred accounts of natural scientific findings. They are constructed, linguistically constructed, as propositions backed by data, which makes it difficult for scientists to credit themselves as being the inventor or creator or constructor of theories, claiming instead that they are discovered. And the institution of science requires that theories be published, be in communication with others, bring them into interaction with each other, and with particular practices. So here you see the theories are not isolated, they are always in interaction with other theories, preceding ones, co-occurring ones, and so that is it's a species. Theories is a species in the ecology of language. And I'm adopting here, and I just want not that many arguments about it, I'm adopting the pragmatic epistemology of radical constructivism, insisting that representational notions of language or theory are unsustainable. Instead, theories need to be viable to their beholders. More specifically, theories need to be afforded by what their proponents do with them. When my students asked, well, what do you mean by that? I said, well, you can have a theory of you being Spider-Man, and you can go on top of a roof and jump down and your theory is gone. So that means the theories need to be, when enacted, need to provide or preserve the lives of its beholder. So, I mean, among the actions that people take that behold or that believe or assume certain theories are generating evidence by experiments. That's what scientists do, acting successfully on their predictions, informing practices, building material artifacts, withstanding criticism, being the seed for further development. This is all what people do with theories, and I think they need to survive these processes. Social theories are a little different. Social theories are concerned with the social interactions and related phenomena with society at large. Their publication enters them into the very subject matter they address. Their reflexivity has been noted since some time. Howard, in 1974, wrote about this, and the basic proposition is the reproduction of social theories can affect what they claim to describe. This is different in the natural sciences, biology, physics, geology. Either gaining validity they did not possess when they were proposed, or losing their validity after becoming known. This undermines the idea of a sociology modeled after the natural sciences. But I want to be more specific. These two effects are akin to negative and positive feedback, deviation reducing or deviation amplified. That means whenever a social theory re-enters at the social phenomena that they describe, they do something with it. But I think this is not so clear why that is so. And there comes, let me then briefly say, how have sociologists dealt with this issue? One particular person, sociologist Robert Merton, he coined the word self-fulfilling prophecies. And I think the interesting part is he called it prophecies as distinct from theories which are supposed to predict. And then prophecy has some sort of a negative connotation for him. But there are lots of examples, like the 1927 run on the banks, the 1973 oil crisis, and I remember in West Philadelphia when there was just the news that there would be no oil, no gasoline available, a number of cars that went around the block to gasoline stations were huge, and very soon there was no gasoline, therefore validating the prophecy that was initially wrong. Or Wall Street issues describing a company as almost failing has great effects on the way their stocks is traded. And this is, for example, what Soros reflexivity is dealing with. For prophecies to be self-fulfilling, they must be believed to be true, result in acting on them, and with the effect of supporting the prophecy. I think the word action is very important. If you don't act, then it doesn't mean anything, it stays that way. But I think people act on theories, on prophecies, and that makes a difference. So now, how did sociologists defend themselves or avoided that problem, or not tackle the problem? Well, one is that to theorize abstractly, so that ordinary people cannot relate to their predictions. For example, using specialized terminology, mathematical models that are virtually not understandable by those who are theorized. Or theorizing the behavior of other people, historical, distant ones, or the enemies, those despised. But most importantly, I think by claiming to describe facts, without realizing that their language constitutes these facts. I think that we have to, come even more to that. Or describe them in causal, circular, or structural determinisms, convincingly backed by scientific authority, abstract systems like rhetoric or behavioral studies of influence, in effect denying or having no place for human agency in these theories. These are tricks that sociologists have adopted, and it prevents them actually from allowing change to occur. So, yet self-fulfilling predictions are of a considerable practical importance. Quite commonly, in running organizations, businesses, succeeding in stock markets or psychotherapy. If you don't believe when joining a company that it will be a successful company, it won't be a successful company. So I think, or in therapy, if you don't believe that therapy will be helpful, that you won't go there. So I think the beliefs in the success of something is of considerable importance. So it's these so-called self-fulfilling prophecies, or I would say predictions, are of considerable practical importance. So when social theories reach those theorized therein, that means those theories that are the target of the theory, one has the choice of either identifying with these theories or and not just respond to them. It's also possible to display agency and oppose or revolt against them. For example, Karl Marx's doomsday theory of predicting the inevitability of monopoly capitalism and its violent overthrow by the oppressed working classes invited anti-monopoly legislation and legitimized, in the United States, the persecution of political subversive groups, thereby undoing the predictions that was meant to be a determinant and was supposed to come in any case. So Marxism is dead not because it was wrong, but because people acted against the theory about them. Or the Black is Beautiful movement of the 1970s countered the then present theories of the inferiority of Afro-Americans. Or the gay movement has been doing exactly the same, opposing the theory they were given. Nelle Neumann, I don't know if you know her, a communication theorist, developed the spiral of silence theory to call attention to the voices of those that are silenced by the mass media, intended to awaken their voices and oppose them. Or interventions in Alcohol Anonymous confronted someone with who they, in quote, really are by their friends, are meant to encourage reflections and where they want to continue, whether they want to continue who they are or want to change. So there is a good deal of in going in that direction and not following the sociological strategies of avoiding agency. So there's an interesting existential axiom that I'd like you to consider, and that is by Nigel Howard. And it deals actually, he dealt with work with game theory, in which players interact and predict each other's opponents and need to be successful. If they want to be successful, they need to be well doing it well. So he coined this axiom called existential. So in a non-mathematical term, faced by a theory that predicts their behavior, humans can always disobey it. It's a choice to conform to predictions. Now that's pretty radical, but I think it is correct. No, I get too much. So it applies actually to whether you are living already with a particular theory and can shift from one to the other, or you don't live in a particular theory and are for the first time exposed to who you are or what the theory about you is. It implies that individual behavior is not caused by articulations in language. Language is not a causal force. Language can't force you to do anything. Its attribute existential is consistent with Heideggerian notions, who in many, many different ways always said the nature of being human lies in a concern for their being. Another interesting reflexive move. It echoes the work of scholars and narratives, equating identity with one's autobiography, but also insisting that all narratives can be re-articulated in different situations by different peoples, not necessarily following their previous articulations. And it denies biological and cognitive determinisms as adequate accounts of issues in the ecology of language. Acting on theories that can alter structural coupling, coordination, communication, the effects of predictions, and the questions on observation-based social science. So one can act on these theories. One is not bound by structural coupling. So now I think Gregory Bateson had actually a similar idea by saying any message communicates not just content, which we typically focus on, but also constitutes relationships. So if someone screams at you, that establishes a relationship regardless of what he screams about. And we talked yesterday in the movie, there were several examples of the double bind, which is precisely that. Now relations are so many, and I think one should not simply, I think this is often too simple to say, we have to look at relations or relationships. There are so many different kinds. There are causal relationships, which I'm not even interested in the moment, but there are issues of transactions, symbolic interactions by George Herbert Mead, information transmission, structural coupling, being with, in Heidegger's terms, mutual understanding. These are all relationships. But also the famous saying, everything is said by an observer, to which Hans von Förster added, everything is said to an observer. Now this implies, of course, both an interest in language, but also in a relationship aspect of language. But it doesn't say anything more. So I think we have all of these above, these relationships that one can explore, they're always theorized from the outside. Someone from the outside observes and describes the relationship. And I think that doesn't allow the individuals or those involved in relationships to define it for themselves. So I think one of the other species that I will briefly mention, but only to get to another proposition, is question answers. That is very typical of much of language, that we ask questions and get answers. Interviewing, problem solving, testing performances, showing interest in other people's lives. or they come through asking questions and getting answers. That is a relationship between someone asking questions, being interested, and someone giving an answer, etc., etc. But even regarding the physics as the crown of the natural sciences, Heisenberg at some point said, work in physics consists in asking questions about nature in the language we possess and trying to get an answer from the experiments by the means that we have at our disposal. When, for example, last night, I remember hearing, we have to just look at nature and learn from nature. Well, it's the questions that we ask from nature and the experiments that we have or the means of observations we have that gives us the answer, not nature. So I think the surprising quote acknowledges that physics is carried out in language, which I think many physicists would deny. Suggests that answers are found in doing something, making experiments, acting in some ways, not just in observation, and presumes that answers account for the actions and consequences, consequent findings. That means whatever is published as theory gives actually an account of what someone does and what someone has generated as a consequence. But it fails to acknowledge that these questions arise in conversations among physicists and the readings of their publications. It fails also to acknowledge that the answers offered need to withstand comparison with other theories promoted within a community of physicists for similar phenomena. Most of the theories in physics are discussed and negotiated, and the truth is almost secondary. But of course, that's what makes something true, is entering the conversations. So there comes an interesting accountability principle as a subspecies of asking questions and getting answers, namely John Schotter's accountability principle. And he said, everything said is said in the expectations of being held accountable for it. Now, I would like to suggest to replace this phrase or replace the Umberto Maturana's phrase, everything said is said by an observer, by saying everything said is said in the expectations of being held accountable for it. Or more generally, everything done in the presence of or with consequences to others is done in the expectation of being held accountable for it. Being held accountable is, I think, the key part of establishing a relationship. So, what does it mean? It's manifest in so-called conversational triples, at least triples. Namely, someone makes a request for an account for an unexpected or unusual or problematic situation. And someone, the one who is asked, is responds by offering an account, a remedial account that will explain why things are the way they are, or what is to be done, etc. And the one who asks the question can either accept the account as adequate or continues the conversations and go on, or as inadequate and re-articulate the request until some satisfaction is received, or simply is forced to withdraw from the conversation. So I think the most common accounts are explanations, justifications, excuses, and apologies. Let me just briefly mention them in detail. Explanations are offered when something said or done is unintelligible to you. For example, when theories require explanations, then we give an explanation. In fact, theories are explanations of observations that other people could make as well. When difficult to understand, theorists may be asked to explain them. Much of scientific writing explains what a theory is about. So that is an account. And again, if one takes the theory as an isolated entity, that's one thing. But if one takes the theory as an account in a relationship, in a conversation, then we have reintroduced the issue of relationships. Justifications accept someone's agency, someone has done something, and they are offered when there is virtue in having done so. In board meetings. I mean, if someone proposes a new business plan, one needs to justify that business plan to those affected in order to get them on board. And that is our justifications. And I think many of the articulations that we observe are of that kind. Then there are excuses. And this is, one admits there is some negative significance of something said or done, but denies agency for it, claiming accidents, appealing to circumstances beyond one's control, having had no choice, or pointing to other people's responsibility. I mean, I could give you examples, but I hope that you realize, you know, when you come too late to a meeting, you find excuses. And this is the question of whether they're acceptable. If they're not acceptable, then you ask for further accounts. Why didn't you take an earlier train? Why didn't you set your alarm properly, et cetera, et cetera? Well, these are excuses. And the fourth one are apologies, which accept the agency, that means that someone did something with negative significance, but it entails the promise of not doing it again and trying to repair the relationship caused by these negative significances. So I think this accountability principle, I would simply take as an axiom that we would not be able to speak publicly with others without having some sort of a possibility of an account in mind. I mean, you think yesterday when, I mean, we didn't do very much interaction, but there were many statements made, and I could have easily said, well, please explain that. And then I'm asking for an explanation. Or I'm objecting to this and saying the consequences would be disastrous. But I'm sure everyone who said something had in mind that he would be held accountable for what he says. I don't think we can do otherwise. And that is the social nature of actually conversation in general. So now, indeed, practicing accountability, several things are interesting that are being constructed inside the conversation. One is there is a speaker or actor, someone who is responsible for whatever one is talking about, the one who is addressed to ask for an account. Then there is a nature of what was said or done, the action. I mean, we often don't know from the outside where the action starts and where the action ends. What is an action? Is it an action, etc., etc.? But in accounting, these things are settled by someone asking for an account and people responding to the request for an account. Then I think it takes for granted that the speaker or actor had choices. Now, there are lots of theories, including in biology and physics, that human beings don't have choices, that is a myth. Well, it may be a myth, I don't care. The point is, in social situations, such as account, when one is asked for account, choices are implied. And of course you can deny it, that make an excuse, you can deny having made a choice, but the point is, a choice is socially constructed. And we live with these choices all the time. And it presumes a community of concerned stakeholders, namely those who are either affected or have a stake in that, and would then ultimately be the judge of whether the account is acceptable. So it forms an ethics that is distributed among participants, not externally imposed. And I think this is important to me. We can easily talk about ethical systems and talk about the ethical responsibility in ecology, in biology, etc., etc. But these are external things. One has to see how it is done within conversations. Yes, and within conversations, one can talk about ecological responsibility, but it needs to be accepted within that. So the ethics is distributed if one takes the accountability as a principle. So, and I would say all of these occur in conversations in which participants hold each other accountable, and that goes on all the time. So the ability to hold each other accountable, I think, is a fundamental social competence. By social, I mean that one takes account of other people. It enters the assessment of in the conversations and in the very conversation that is assessed, when they can distinguish five reflexivities which surface in this kind of comparison. Now, for example, someone's conception and someone's experience of that conception, so when you're confronted with something like this, then we talk about disconfirmations or confirmations. This is very simple. But there's issue of disagreement when someone's conception is confronted with someone else's conception as assertive. That's an issue of disagreement. Well, I don't want to go further, but that's the issue of understanding and misunderstanding, the issue of being misunderstood or being understood. And then there's finally the issue of final realization, which is a form of agreement of each other's reflexive understanding. That means A's understanding of B's understanding of A's understanding of something, and the same thing on the other side. So I'm mentioning that not to get too complicated, but to say there's more to just say understanding. So in practice, such reflectivities do not involve regress into infinity, as our mathematicians always point out. They are very common, and we aren't afraid of infinite regresses when we talk about them. So I think in the negative, I want to point out that John Schotter's accountability principle applies also to the issue of emerging authority. For example, if stakeholders fail to hold speakers and actors accountable for problematic assertions, actions, or situations, whether for expedience or fear of reprisals, so if people are not held responsible, accountable for it, then consequently those speakers don't need to speak in the expectations of being held accountable and can say whatever they want. And that constitutes authority. So I think this is a diversion, if you want, from that principle. Now, the principle is valid, but I think if people don't take advantage of holding other people accountable, authorities arise, powers arise, etc., etc. Now, I want to talk about a bigger issue that is kind of social theory so far. And discourses are also species in the ecology of language. To me, a discourse is manifest in self-constrained conversations and writing. For example, if you're a physicist and you write an article in a physics journal, then you have to comply with certain kinds of constraints. You cannot, for example, you should avoid saying I, my feelings. It's all irrelevant. You have to comply with certain kinds of rules that the discourse of physics prescribes, or that you subscribe by being a physicist. So I think that self-constrained conversations is critical. Or if you are in a formal situation, you use formal language. And that is kind of a constrained form of communication. To me, conversation is kind of the most free kind of social interaction that one can think of. So this is a complex language game, one could say. And there are particular species in the ecology of language. There are professional discourses. There are scientific discourses. There are religious discourses. There are sports discourses. Situationally appropriate discourses, such as a conversation with policemen on the street. There's public discourse, there's also cybernetic discourse, there's Batesonian discourse, etc., etc. These are all separate discourses. Now, I know from yesterday, everyone would say, oh, let's all mix everything together, but in practice, that isn't the case. I think if someone would stand up here and say, I want to talk about a mathematical theory that interests me. Well, then you say, so what? We are here to talk about Bateson ideas, cybernetic ideas, and that is where the constraint comes in. So like conversations, all discourses are self-organizing. Physics is a self-organizing discourse. No biologist can tell physicists how to do good physics. No psychologist can tell systems theories to do better systems theory. These are separate issues, and every discourse organizes itself from within. So what distinguishes one discourse from another is indigenous to each and interactively manifest in these five components. Namely, there's always a discourse community, there are always artifacts constructed, there's a recurrent practices which are institutionalized, there are boundaries drawn and maintained, and they are justified to other discourses. I will talk about that more specifically. So I think ecological interactions between these discourses involve these components, but especially their ability to control the practices at their boundary. Now, I know from yesterday, I don't think you like boundaries, but they are real. So I think, let me just say a few things about discourse. A discourse is kept alive by a discourse community, obviously. I mean, physics doesn't exist without physicists. Biology doesn't exist without biologists. This is a form of talking, writing, acting that is typical of a particular type of discourse community. And in order to be part of the members of the discourse community, you have to be qualified in some form or the other. You have to be competent in practicing that discourse. For example, to be a member of any scientific community, you have to do years of studying to become literate. I mean, that's what university education is all about, is to become literate in a particular type of discourse, after which you can get a certification, a degree, and maybe you write a dissertation, maybe you do more, and you can then become hired as a professor. So then you are competent participant in a discourse. The self-organization of a discourse is evident in the practices by members to hold each other accountable. And you have no idea, or you probably do have an idea, when you write a paper, there are reviewers. They say, oh, this doesn't fit this journal, or this is not good physics, or this is not good whatever. And these are where people hold each other accountable for maintaining the discourse in which they are working. But the interesting part is, unlike, I think, biological organisms, discourses are not as solid as machines, as organisms. Machines, organisms, ecologies, I mean ecologies of species, they're always connected simultaneously. In discourses, they're not. We are sitting here. In 4 days, you are with your family, you are different in a different discourse. You may be stopped for a traffic violation, you are in a different discourse. So we shift from one discourse to another, have the ability to change our identity as we move from one thing to another. A discourse exists only as long as there are conversations within people participating in that discourse. Well, this is why I think biological metaphors of organizations are inappropriate or should be avoided to understand, for example, what organizations are about. I mean, even the notion of organization comes from organs, that organs are working together constantly. I think it's a mistake. That describes, in fact, much of organizational theory, it deals with organizations as a whole, as it exists. Or in fact, systems theory, same thing. Yeah? Systems exist in the interconnections. The point is actually, at least in the social domain, these interconnections are constantly revamped from one kind of system to another kind of system. Systems are very transient and they don't exist as wholes all the time. They are reconstituted each time people become part of it. Now, in the literature, there are a lot of different kinds of conceptions of discourse. Many of them say it's just a matter of writing, a writing beyond the sentence level. But I think my point is actually the important part is what discourses do. And all discourses, and here I had a big struggle with physicists, all discourses, in my opinion, construct their own artifacts. What are their artifacts? For example, in physics. Physics, right? Physics construct a universe, and the universe is an artifact of physics. Biology constructs living systems. Their constructions has nothing to do, or not, it doesn't influence how living systems live. but it is a construction. So I think text is one kind of artifact. Discourses or other kinds of artifacts, like architects building houses, the language part is perhaps less significant, but an architect makes drawings, negotiates with codes, hires contractors, etc. All is done in language, and the language is inscribed in whatever it comes about. Well, I think I have to go a little faster here, I see. And I think the important part is that these texts, the artifacts that the discourse makes has a different life than the conversation that creates them. For example, we live here, when I come here to California, I was just stunned at the roads and bridges that exist, they have existed for years and years, and they will exist, continue to exist, and they were constructed at some point, and we live with them now. So the artifacts that the discourse of building constructs have a longer life than ourselves. The same thing is with texts. And why do we go to libraries? Because we have access to things that are written a long time ago. So I think discourses continuously reconstruct their own artifacts, subsequently constraining some of the developments while enabling others. Think about the invention of telephones. It's a fantastic device. But it restricts our conversation to verbal articulations, no taste, no touch, nothing. But it allows us to extend the ability to talk to many people outside our normal reach. So there's always a constraining and enabling aspect. So I think, Anthony Giddens calls this kind of a duality of structure, or kind of a dual reflectivity. On the one side, is there always this constraining part, that whatever we have constrains what we can do next. On the other hand, that very same existence can enable. And I think, ideally, the benefits of enablement exceed the cost of structural constraints. But that is not necessarily so, and maybe in the end we come to some other conclusions. But the most discursive artifacts possess materiality, that is true. But there are also lots of social artifacts. A social artifact, like a social organization, works by enabling the expectations that its participants bring to the conversations in writing. That means if you are a member of the family, I expect that all members of the family think that they are members of the family, and that is in fact makes a family. When one member thinks I'm not a member of the family, then that family doesn't include that member. So there has to be some sort of expectation of our own expectation of other people's expectations. So now I think at the core of social organizations, all discourses institutionalize their current practices. By recurrent practices, I mean the kind of things that they have done all the time. They want to continue and preserve them. They are sometimes considered ethical, moral, but they're also considered self-policing. Because when institutions are established or believed, they are usually not written down, they are re-articulated. They are not articulated in writing, in text, but they are nevertheless effective by saying by judging others. For example, when I say, my neighbor's family is dysfunctional. Well, what do I say? I'm talking actually about two different kinds of things. One is my neighbor's family, they have names, I've seen them, I know them. And the other one is my judgment that they're dysfunctional. That is an institution. It's not written down what the proper family is, but I have these judgments. This is what institutionalized, all discourses institutionalize their own recurrent practices. And what is good physics is not written in textbook. It's known by everyone by reading lots of different kinds of physical texts. So, and I think they become, social institutions become effective and value different kinds of practices. So like in all self-organizations, organizing systems, the maintenance of a boundary is crucial. Discourses draw and maintain their boundary. Well, I implied already many of these things. For example, regarding the membership of community, that is a boundary. The kind of artifacts that are being created, the kind of objects of interest, the kind of publications, they're all boundary issues at the end, at the margin of which there isn't quite, one could say, an either-or type of decision whether it belongs or doesn't. And that's again a linguistic game. Does it belong or doesn't? So I think this is to me, I think, a very critical part of all discourses, that they are, by virtue of the fact that they're self-organizing, they need to preserve their boundary. But I think, I said this already, unlike in biological and mechanical systems, the components, they continuously, do not continuously interact. They cross boundaries. For example, members of different discourses may become members of one. And they bring certain kinds of things with them. For example, metaphors. An example is in physics is energy. Now, energy in ordinary discourse was something like lively, active, etc., etc. When it entered physics, it became a formula that is integrated in the system of thermodynamics, and then it becomes something totally different. And then it gets back, in fact, to everyday discourse, and when I now ask, what is energy, then I'm probably getting a physics answer and not an everyday life answer. So that is, I think, typical. And that students need to be recruited in any discourse. So there has to be, the boundary has to be porous. Financial resources need to enter. If research isn't funded, the discourse usually vegetates or has all kinds of strange life ends. Or supplies from other discourses in return for artifacts that serve them. So I think in order to be able to do that, discourse needs to justify their practices to outsiders. And I think physicists are great in doing that. I mean, they are maintaining that is the best science, the only science actually of all other sciences. But it is done in all other kinds of discourses as well. You know, marketing says that we are the mover of the commercial system. Well, these are all justifications, and I think without justification, a discourse perishes. So now there are a lot of ecological interactions between discourses. For example, I said that already. Members, as I said, members bring different kinds of ideas into a discourse and can undermine this or enrich the discourse. And when we, for example, here talk about looking at different kinds of disciplines, I think that is part of it where different kind of terminology enters a particular type of discourse. Paradigms from other more prestigious discourses, conceptually more desirable discourses are adopted. For example, physics or physical measurements, and when adopted in psychology, creates psychophysics, or homeostasis, adopted from cybernetics in family therapy, is doing, introduces certain kinds of ideas. Or methods of other discourses fill a gap and undermining the discourse's integrity. For example, computer modeling in conversation theory. And that I think when once you insist that a conversation needs to be modeled by a computer, then you to stop understanding what a conversation is and you undermine that possibility. And essential artifacts of one discourse may be usurped by other discourses, undermining the distinctiveness or their source. Well, that's, for example, what happens in cybernetics. So many people have borrowed, or one can say stolen, ideas of cybernetics and make their own and leave cybernetics kind of in a different kind of state of affairs. So discourses may vanish or move into insignificant niches. Astrology, for example, phrenology, or Marxist sociology. Or discourse may grow in prestige, leading weaker discourses to import some of its conceptions and thereby accepting to be colonized. economics colonializing social sciences. Cognitive science has basically eroded psychology. One discourse may take over another, like for example cognitive science is doing to psychology or pharmaceutics is doing to psychoanalysis. There are pathologies of epistemology, like Bateson's purposive rationality, and we talked yesterday about that, where pathologies make it impossible for the discourse to flourish. Discourses may be considered themselves of universal significance, trying to subsume others under their umbrella, like mathematics, physics, general systems theory, and biology. That is a kind of an imperialism evident in the ecology of language of discourse. And regarding the latter, I would say a discourse that claims to be fundamental to all others or providing universal truth is not cognizant of its language and its discursive nature. So now, let me turn this over now and talk about the discourse of cybernetics, having talked about the cybernetics of discourse so far. Applying cybernetics of discourse to cybernetics, I'm suggesting that cybernetics be cognizant of its unique discursivity. It should acknowledge being part of the ecology of language and kept alive therein by its conversations, writings, and other artifacts created by the discourse community of cyberneticians. Second, I would say that cybernetics should be dedicated to discursively construct artifacts, whether they are material, computational, or social, that embody the circularity, diversity, autonomy, and self-organizations, open reflexive possibilities to their stakeholders, and to exercise their agency in participating in social patterns of interaction. They're enabling communication and technological infrastructures to emerge. And thirdly, when Margaret Mead suggested in 1968 that cyberneticians apply cybernetics to themselves, I should like to say she did not talk about second-order observers. Rather, she argued that an expansion of the language of cybernetics to embrace the social uses of cybernetic ideas or artifacts in accepting accountability for the changes this language introduces in how we come to live in society. The action is important. And I think when we get stuck in observation, first order or second order observations, we don't act anymore. And I think that is a big mistake. The ability to apply it to itself has some precedences, but it's not universally possible or not available to all discourses. Like what would be a geography of geography? At least I can't imagine it. Well, I had here now a whole history of different kinds of contributions, and I will not go into the details. I mentioned already Merton, Herbert Simon worked on this. Karl Popper talked about this as an Oedipal effect, and this was, for example, picked up by George Soros. This is one form of reflexivity. In the 1960s, 70s, I think this is probably the most important to me area of study. The sociology of scientific knowledge emerged. The strong program insists that sociology apply itself to sociology. Margaret Mead's 1968 suggestion already mentioned. Gregory Bateson's notion of using meta messages as an explanation of that reflexivity. Heinz von Förster's second order cybernetics, I have my criticism of that. Gadamer's hermeneutics, based actually on Heidegger's much earlier work, but probably not so clearly formulated, it introduced the hermeneutic circle. And Donald Schoen's reflective practitioner is also well known. But now, sadly, I would say cybernetics has not lived up over the history to its promises of becoming an established science. And I think I want to mention three reasons. One is the popular understanding of control in its original definition does not match its technical meaning. And cyberneticians have not been able to overcome this negative connotation. The same can be said about the common association of cybernetics with robotics. When I'm saying I'm a cybernetician, they always say, oh, you build some robots. Well, cyberneticians have not been able to market their discourse in high-profile publications, textbooks, conferences, educational institutions, and jobs. Now, we're sitting here and there's something moving, but it is just not enough, I think. And however, one has to say, to me at least, cyberneticians have displayed an amazing intellectual creativity, ushering the computer revolution, digital technology, game theory, self-organizing systems, issues of autonomy, autobiotic conceptions, the cybernetics of cybernetics, and I would add the internet as a communication infrastructure of our contemporary society. They failed to build the institutions needed to bring these concepts to fruition within a coherent discourse. Other disciplines have adopted and developed cybernetic conceptions and thrived with them. Cognitive science, artificial intelligence, gaming theory, complexity science, internet-based businesses, including political revolutions. So that brings me, I would argue that the best thing that cyberneticians can do is continue creating and developing reflexive constructions that have so far fertilized many other disciplines and enriched other people's lives. I suggest consider defining cybernetics as the interdisciplinary discourse that brings forth radical reflexive realities. As a discourse, members of its community cannot avoid being cognizant of their reflexive involvement in conversations and publications shaping the ecology of artifacts as species of language. And I do mean that as a qualitative shift from talking about feedback and ecology to talking about the language that we use to do so. As an interdisciplinary endeavor, I would say cyberneticians have to be able to cooperate with many disciplines, important without losing their identity in their own discourse. And the attention to reflexivity includes the ability to talk expertly of the great variety of circular constructions, feedback, monitoring, self-reference, self-organization, conversation, autonomy, emergence, accountability, hermeneutics, and discourse. Bringing forth realities implies agency, not stopping at observing and describing, understanding or explaining what is, rather than actively changing it to the better. I think that is a component we have largely overlooked. So I'm inviting you to join this large discourse of cybernetics. Thanks for listening.
Now, you'll be aware that we started late and I had some things to say, so I took a little of Klaus's hour and he's spoken for his hour. So we have that usual problem of balancing time. And what I would like to suggest is that we have now 2 or 3 hours, starting with a coffee break and moving into the paper, into the poster session. And I would like to suggest that rather than have formal questions for Klaus, there is the possibility during the coffee break and the poster session of talking with him, so that it'll be possible to have more private rather than public questions, but we will be able to return closer to our schedule, without which we're going to end up in a lot of trouble at the end of the day, because things like the time of dinner are absolutely fixed by Asilomar. There isn't any flexibility. So with Klaus's agreement, I hope, thank you, and with your agreement, I'm going to propose that we thank Klaus once again for an extraordinarily clear and wide-ranging presentation. and that we move to the back of the room. And if you'd just like to gather around the table there, there is another little surprise for Klaus, which I have to say owes an enormous amount to Pile. When I tell you that, well, I'll tell you up there. That's the best thing to do. So please move to the back of the room.
To facilitate the discussion, I thought I'll write down all of these key propositions, and so I leave this here for you to
thank you
to talk.
We have made for Klaus a birthday cake.
I guess it's
and it is decorated with one of the wonderful posters that he made for the ASC, which explains something or shows something of Klaus as a designer. This is a recursive image, and Pile spent many hours getting it right from a really bad photograph. And this is the special treat for this coffee break only. It's Klaus's birthday cake, and I invite you, please, to ceremonially cut it, and then we'll get it chopped up, and there'll be some for everyone. So, Klaus,
okay,
many congratulations.
Well, I have to say thank you very much. I'm overwhelmed, but I don't think I earned it.
Neither do I.
So, how should I start?
He opened the door.
The cyberneticians sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Klaus.
Gregory, Bateson,
happy birthday to you.
Now I have to blow the candles out.
Yep.
Oh, six.
Ooh.